space and the privilege to be together in community. I invite you to stand as you are able, and we'll begin on hymn 704.
Thank you.
know is everlasting life. Grant us so perfectly to know your Son, Jesus Christ, to be the way, the truth, and the life, that we may steadfastly follow his steps in the way that leads to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated for our meeting today.
This reading is from the book of Acts. An angel of the Lord said to Philip, "Get up and go toward the south to the road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a wilderness road." So he got up and went. Now there was an Ethiopian eunuch, a court official of Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, in charge of her entire treasury. He had come to Jerusalem to worship and was returning home. Seated in his chariot, he was reading the prophet Isaiah. Then the Spirit said to Philip, "Go over to this chariot and join it." So Philip ran up to it and heard him reading the prophet Isaiah. He asked, "Do you understand what you are reading?" He replied, "How can I unless someone guides me?" And he invited Philip to get in and sit beside him. Now the passage of scripture that he was reading was this: "Like a sheep, he was led to the slaughter, and like a lamb silent before its shearer, so he does not open his mouth. In his humiliation, justice was denied him. Who can describe this generation? For his life is taken away from the earth." The eunuch asked Philip, "About whom, may I ask you, does the prophet say this, about himself or about someone else?" Then Philip began to speak, and starting with this scripture, he proclaimed to him the good news about Jesus. As they were going along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, "Look, here is water. What is to prevent me from being baptized?" He commanded the chariot to stop, and both of them, Philip and the eunuch, went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip away. The eunuch saw him no more and went on his way rejoicing. But Philip found himself at Azotus, and as he was passing through the region, he proclaimed the good news to all the towns until he came to Caesarea. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Together we will read the psalm, Psalm 22. I will begin and you will respond at the after. My praise is of him in the great assembly.
I will perform my vows in the presence of those who worship him.
The poor shall eat and be satisfied, and those who seek the Lord shall praise him.
May your heart live forever.
All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord.
And all the families of the nations shall bow before him.
For kingship belongs to the Lord.
He rules over the nations.
To him alone, all who sleep in the earth bow down in worship.
All who go down to the dust fall before him.
My soul shall live on him. My descendants shall serve him.
They shall be known as the Lord forever.
They shall come and make known to a people yet unborn
the saving deeds that he has done.
John. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. And this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him, and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father has sent his Son as the Savior of the world. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. So we have known and believe the love that God has for us. God is love. And those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he first loved us. Those who say, "I love God," and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit, Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as a branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.
Amen.
May be seated. Well, it is such a joy to be here with you all today, and goodness, you probably saw in that first reading, and then you saw, in the second reading, the epistle from John, and then you saw in the Gospel of John these themes of love, these themes of connection, the vine grower, the vineyard, and all about just the core of our gospel and love in 1 John. But seated in all of this, I actually want to talk about Acts, which was the first reading that we had today. And you all, I know I haven't been here that long, but you've probably picked up on this. Every time we're in a new church season, I probably say this is my favorite church season. I love the change. I love the different tone and feel that it brings. But Easter, I do really love the season of Easter, and in part is what feels different about it. If you notice through our readings that I was describing throughout the year, we have an Old Testament, typically a psalm, one of the letters that's written in the New Testament to the churches from the apostles, and then of course the gospel, one of the four gospels, and that bounces around a bit. And generally you sort of follow through a story or it matches the season of the year. But Easter, if you didn't notice, is different. What was our first reading from today?
Acts.
Acts, yeah, which is one of the books of the New Testament. So it changes up because it's leading us through Acts and telling us the story of what happened after the resurrection. So as we're living ourselves present day in the joy of the resurrection, we are walking through the first kind of joy and journey after the resurrection in Acts. And I don't know why my head goes to this, and I can't imagine a scenario, God forbid this were to be the case, but if for some reason, God forbid, the Bible was lost to history, and somehow we only had one book of it to remain, I mean, if you really push me, I suppose we would have to choose one of the Gospels, but if we could remain one, my gut is to go with Acts, because Acts is this incredibly special narrative story full of teachings and full of sermons that recount the whole history of the Bible. So you have these amazing stories from Stephen and Peter and Paul, and they go back to Genesis and talk about the story of God and his people. They relate it all into the joy of the resurrection. They preach the gospel throughout Acts, and it points towards what we are called to do as the people of God. It's a powerful book. If you haven't spent a lot of time reading the Bible, Acts is actually a great place to start. It's engaging, and it's directive, and it's beautiful. So, where we're at in Acts, to kind of just get us to our first reading for today, we have the resurrection, then of course the ascension that happens at the end of the Gospels, and Jesus and the Great Commission that says, go, baptize in the name, in my name, and share the gospel. Then it kind of ends. Then we go right into Acts. And in an ideal world, sorry, I'm getting a little teacher on this, but if we were to pull the Gospel of John out, I sort of wish it was in a different order, because Luke and Acts were written together by the same author, and it's supposed to sort of be one book, two volumes, if you will. So if you go right from Luke, and the Great Commission, and Jesus ascending, then Acts begins. And where we pick up, even though it's such an action-based book, you pick up a little bit with the disciples twiddling their thumbs. Because what happens is Jesus ascends, and then they're like, look, Jesus says, hang tight, something's coming. And they're like, what are we waiting for? And not really know what to do. So they find themselves again in an upper room, kind of waiting. And I guess I can't fault them, because what would you do if your friend, your leader, the Messiah, had risen, and you just shared a fish with him, and then the next thing you know, he ascended into heaven, and you're sort of, what's next? So that's starting to be where we find ourselves. Then, what we celebrate in a few weeks, Pentecost, early Acts, Holy Spirit comes down, flames of fire, there's joy, there's action. All of a sudden, the disciples know what to do. The early followers of Jesus are feeling the power of the Holy Spirit in their lives and beginning to change the world. And this high energy book of Acts, it says that people thought they were drunk. There was so much energy and excitement. And that's not just because there was a bunch of early Episcopalians getting together. It was generally the joy of the Holy Spirit in their midst. Then miracles are happening. Martyrdoms are happening. The disciples are starting to preach. And that's what gets us to our story for today in the beginning of Acts. So what happens in this story? It's a continuation of this creation, fall, redemption, the redemption of the world being lived out. In Acts, generally, we see the church working the way that it can. We see the people of God working almost to their kind of fullest capacity. Of course, there's challenges and problems, but it's pointing towards what we can be given a mission to live into. People were living in community. No one wanted anything. They were sharing with one another. The Spirit of God was leading them. It's an amazing time. And all through Acts, you see these themes, kind of two takeaways. One, that Jesus came for everyone, for the whole world, that all who through Jesus believe and live into this are welcome in the kingdom of God, a kingdom of love. So that theme is all throughout Acts. Jesus didn't just come for his family or just for the people of Israel. He did for them, but beyond. The second theme is that the Holy Spirit is active and present. And those are the two sort of things that hold these together. So I hope all of this helps with this first story, which is we see an Ethiopian official on his way from Jerusalem to Gaza. And I'm going to pause right there. Those of us who are prayerfully following the news and praying for God's love and mercy, what a thing to stumble upon this reading. Jerusalem to Gaza was where God was leading Philip. So Philip came. The Spirit led him. And then he bumped into this Ethiopian official. They start talking. We don't know if this Ethiopian official was there. It said he went to worship in Jerusalem. He might have been part of the Jewish diaspora in Ethiopia. He might have just been exploring. We don't know. But they came in contact. They had a conversation. The Spirit was present and alive and active. The Ethiopian official said, let's get baptized right here. Here's a river. And Philip said, great, let's do it. And they baptized him. And then it said the Spirit picked up Philip and moved him to do the next kind of thing that the Spirit was calling him to do. So this is sort of how I want to begin to wind up talking today. In Godly Play, which is a curriculum used by many parts of the Episcopal Church, or mainline churches for children, it's where you learn sort of Montessori based by playing with stories, and then the story kind of becomes your own. In Godly Play, it's framed around I wonder questions, which is in different facets, not just children's curriculum too, but asking questions that start with I wonder, then you continue on. And I love that posture because I think what it does is it helps leave space for the Holy Spirit in our lives. I wonder blank. So today, for a high energy reading, framed in these other readings about love and abiding in Christ, what would it look like for us to just pause with some I wonder questions and see where the Spirit might move? So the first one, based on our story, I wonder what the world would look like if we were more open to the leading of the Holy Spirit and open to seeing what would happen, like Philip. Can you imagine this? Philip was in a place where he was so attuned to the leading of God that he knew where to go, Jerusalem to Gaza. He knew who to talk to, this Ethiopian official. Then God did God's amazing work in that moment. I wonder what the world would look like if we all created space in our life for the Spirit to work in and through us, as is promised at Pentecost and is promised in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Another I wonder question. I wonder what the world would look like if we were open to changing our minds, to hearing someone else's opinion, and then allowing your mind to just be open to something new, like the Ethiopian, right? What would this world look like if all of us were just a little more flexible, a little willing to engage with someone that might know more than us or might have a different perspective? What would this world look like if we didn't go stuck in our trenches and follow the example of this Ethiopian to say, I don't know, tell me, Philip. And they talked, and from that conversation, again, the Spirit moved, and he was baptized. And what a thing in this day and age where I think it's so tempting to get stuck in our trenches instead of have conversations and learn and grow from each other. I wonder what it would look like. I'm tempted to say Christians, but Christians wasn't the terminology then, right? In Acts, this is the early church, the followers of Jesus. I wonder what it would look like for God's children, the followers of Jesus, to be willing to be a bit spontaneous. Again, sort of a funny laugh for Episcopalians, not also one of our spiritual gifts, spontaneity. But I wonder what it would look like. What if we were on the road and someone said, do you know anything about Jesus? And you said, cool, that's it, and get coffee and talk about it. And oh, hey, let's go get baptized, right? Like, that feels so foreign. But it shouldn't, because this is who we are as the church. We're inheritors of the energy and Spirit of God and Acts. It's still with us and continuing with us. So what if? What if we were more willing to be present with the Spirit like Philip? What if we were willing to hear other perspectives and maybe change our mind or change the way we're looking at things like this Ethiopian? What if we were willing to be spontaneous and see just what happens if we allow God's presence in our lives? And then finally, I wonder what it would be like for me or for you if, like our whole set of readings based on love, if this was our guiding thing in life, love, energy, connection, spontaneity, conversation, relationships, all these are in our readings today. I pray that we can sit with these, and maybe you have different I wonder questions just in life, and there are seasons where it is hard to feel joy and energy because life is bearing down on you. But wherever you can through these cracks, what is it like to wonder, to ask, and see where the Spirit of God is leading you? Amen.
Amen.
I invite us to stand, and we'll say together the Nicene Creed, found on page 358. We believe
in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified on the cross of Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the Scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the
people are in the Book of Common Prayer, page 392. In peace we pray to you, Lord God. For all people in their daily life and work.
For our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone.
For this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and needy.
Praying for all the congregations of our diocese, and today especially for St. Philip's, for Vard, and for the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel, and all who seek the truth.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, and Jose, our bishop, and for all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God in His church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation. Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy,
we thank you, Lord, for all the blessings in this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King.
We praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
Who put their trust in you.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us,
most merciful God. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness. By the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in everlasting life.
Amen.
Well, my friends, on this beautiful day in spring, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you all. You're welcome to make your way back to your seats. Well, a few things today, but first, this is very exciting because I actually see in the bulletin that I know we have some folks to invite forward. Those who are celebrating anniversaries this week, Sandra and Carl, will you all come? Alice and Danny, I know they're here. Yeah, come on up. You've got anniversaries, right? Am I right? Next week? Well, you're in the bulletin, so come on up.
I can't get out.
They changed it.
Are there any other birthdays or things to remember this week? Well, there's one other, and I have to name this as we're saying great thanks and prayers for our community who has been long absent and missed beyond words, and prayers have been surrounding week after week. Merrily, welcome home. Good to have you back. You stay right where you are, but you're going to be included in on this prayer. Loving God, we thank you for your presence in this place. We thank you for those celebrating anniversaries, those celebrating birthdays, those who are recovering from surgeries and illness that are able to be present with us today. We thank you that your hand is on us, that your spirit is part of our lives. And we give you thanks and pray your blessing on all those we're celebrating in particular this week. Amen.
Amen.
All right, y'all can head back. This is like being a teacher again. Please come to the front of the class. A few announcements for our community. I know some of you have announcements too. The first one I want to mention, and I never want to give more details than you need, because you've heard this talked about a lot. So I'm just going to remind, next week we are not here. We are at the beach. Not the ocean, I wish. Maybe someday. Maybe it's a bit of an aggressive goal. We are at Lake Lord's beautiful beachfront pavilion next week at 10 o'clock. Please come. Please invite guests. There's a potluck dinner. If you can bring something, please do to share. If not, just come. Be present. It's a great chance for kids, too, to be able to kind of run around and enjoy the freedom of that place. If it's drizzly, we'll still have it. We're under a roof. If the weather is really a problem, look for a text. And we'll just, of course, pivot to being back here. But my prayer is that we'll all be together next week. I'm just saying it because I don't want you to forget, but if you need details, look in your bulletin. I really want to take a moment to welcome an extremely special guest. Well, two extremely special guests we have with us. Sister Jacqueline, it is a gift to have you. She came early for adult formation, and we were able to hear a little of her story. Sister Jacqueline has been part of our partners, partners in crime is not the right word, our partners in ministry in Cincinnati since 1971 is when you first moved to Cincinnati, and has been all over the country and internationally, I believe, serving the sisters in various capacities, even serving in North Carolina for a time down by Charlotte, and has frequently come back to the retreat house here. Those of you coming, here's another announcement, with the new members' dinner tonight. I believe Sister Jacqueline will be present, yes. So it's another chance to get to know you. What I would, if you don't mind, if you would just stand so we can warmly welcome you to our community back. We would not be a church if it was not for the amazing ministry and commitment of the sisters and all those who continue to carry on the legacy and ministry of the sisters. Yeah. So please, Sister Jacqueline, if you will pass on our warmest welcome and friendship back to the community. And of course, it's your home. You know you are always welcome here, but whenever you're at your home around the corner, this is your home as well. So thank you. And Michelle is HR director?
Generalist.
Works with the sisters as a staff member and graciously drove and accompanied Sister Jacqueline down from Cincinnati. It's a joy to have you here as well. Yeah, thank you. Other announcements? Yeah, please. Our esteemed junior warden was at the 8 o'clock, too. Absolute champ. Good to have him back.
Double dipping today. In Crocs. Good thing. We have a wonderful lawn service who comes and takes care of our beautiful campus every other week during mowing season. But on the opposite weeks, when they are not here, we are looking for volunteers. And all that we mow is the spiritual garden, which is gorgeous at the moment, the little section in front, and if needed, the side here. I did it this week. It takes less than an hour to mow and then to blow off the grass clippings and stuff. The hardest part is figuring out how to get into the shed if you've never done it, but I'll be happy to teach you because it's a jigsaw puzzle to get in there. I have a sign-up sheet in the parish hall by weeks that you would sign up and take a week. Last year, I think Rick did it the whole season. Thank you very much. But I'm looking for a group of people, so just if you have questions, see me.
Just as an opportunity to remind, you all do so much. I'm going to say thank you for that. And Dixie has jumped in full on in junior warden, doing a beautiful job. And Tom is always in all of our vestry. Huge thanks for all you do, and each of you do so much for this parish. Are there other announcements to mention today? Yeah, Mike.
Well, this holds no candle to Sister Jacqueline being here, but Patrick, our fearless leader of the firewood guys, okay, and ladies, we are having a firewood activity on Wednesday from 9 until noon. Most everybody is so excited that, and Patrick is beside himself with excitement about getting together. because as you can see out here in the shed, if you get a chance, drive by, we are starting to fill that shed up. And so come fall, when people need wood for cooking and for heat in their homes, we'll be able to serve them quite well. Thank you.
Thank you. And just as other updates, and just because they had asked, Patrick texted me this morning. They were having a slower morning, but they did want to extend. Michelle's surgery went well a few weeks back. Those of you who have been in touch, and they look forward to being back with the cingulate rotator cuff surgery. And they asked that I share that with you all, that they're doing well and looking forward to being back in the community. And we're thankful for Patrick's leadership as well as all those who do firewood. Are there any other announcements, things to mention this morning? Well, as always, it's a joy to be present. If you are visiting, you are warmly welcomed, and I hope to see you tonight for our new, or if you feel new, dinner to us, and there'll be six of the sisters around the corner. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name. Bring offerings and come into his courts.
God, the Son of God.
Our Eucharist today continues on page 361. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb, who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and amending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And that the last day brings with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him, and with him, and in him. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And
Alleluia. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
Christ our Lord. Amen.
Life is short. We do not know how much time we have to gladden the hearts of those who travel with us. So be swift to love. Make haste to be kind. And may God, who is beyond our ability to fully comprehend, but who knows us, who loves us, and travels with us, bless us. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and keep us in peace. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.